Oh, look at that. What does that say? I think it says we're live.
Yep. Right there. Says
right
we
there,
live.
Right there.
Right up there.
Right
says
there,
we
right
live.
there. I got it right
says
there.
We
Let it
are
take the
live.
on there. Oh my God, it's an extra special quarantine edition.
Oh man, it's the quarantine edition. It's the social this it, yeah, it's the man, I'm telling you. Hey, man, we are live. We are doing this thing. I'm waiting for it to pop up on my daggone screen so I can share it. Man, I'm telling you, we just breaking all the rules, man. We got no schedule, we got no nothing.
No schedule, no promotion. Oh, there it is.
Really?
There.
Share on mine, man. Oh, there it is.
All right.
We live now. I'm gonna hit share. I'm gonna share it on mine. Hey, if you're watching this, share it on yours too. This is the official share minute. We all
share
take a minute.
Minute
to share it. We all take a minute to share it on our timelines. Yep. Share it. Yeah, you share this bad boy. If you're watching this right now, hit share because we're about to talk on something deep.
I know y'all watching it because you got sick of Netflix.
I know
you're ready to watch something else.
You want something new. You want something different. You want something different. Boom.
Different
boom,
times,
boom, boom.
Different vibes, different folks.
All
Come on
kind of
now.
Stuff, man. All right, man. Let me see. Hey, man.
What is happening?
Woo-hoo. Hey,
we're in the house.
It'd be really weird if you don't know who we are because you're watching this. You're probably watching this on our timeline, or you might be watching this from the Mad Men of Masculinity page. But if you don't know, I am Kirk M. Samuels.
And I am Jason B. Kendrick.
Ooh-wee, and we are the Mad Men of Masculinity, baby.
That's right, y'all. We're just real men having real conversations for you. So what are we on to today? It's quarantine special day. What are we doing today?
Hey, let me tell you something, man. It hit me today that 2020 has been like a box of chocolates, man.
Oh,
you ever
yeah.
open a box of chocolates
now?
And it's like, man, you don't know, like, is what is this one? Is, you know, every month, every week is like something totally different, man. And I mean, this is buck wild out
oh, yeah.
here.
The
man.
Way before Scump you. Life is life.
Well, box
of chocolates.
You never know what you're going to get.
Get.
That's how 2020 is, man. We got a snowstorm blizzard going on out here.
I know, first day of spring in Colorado. How you doing?
Man, I'm telling you, man, this is what it is. You know, we went quarantine edition. So I decided you actually went, you got prettied up and all that kind of stuff. I said, you know what, man? I said, I ain't brushed nothing today. Like everybody else watching this right now, you know, you ain't done nothing. Are you still in your pajamas just like me? You ain't brushed nothing just like me. You might have ate a little something, something, but man, I got computers up all, man, working from home, all that kind of stuff, man. This is the official quarantine edition.
Well, see, you know, I had to go and wet my head and comb my hair and wash my face just to try to look like you.
I ain't do nothing, man.
You hadn't done anything all day, and I still had to do work to try to catch up, try to look even close to
what
you
look like. I ain't do nothing,
like.
Man. I'm still
see
in my pajamas, man. I'm still in my pajamas because I figured, you know what? I said, everybody else ain't get dressed up.
That's
I ain't
right.
get dressed. I'm keeping it real today. This is the Keep It Real show, the quarantine edition. This is the social distancing edition of Mad Men of Masculinity here.
That's
and,
right.
I figured I'm going to keep it
speaking of social distancing.
Yeah. Hey, by the way, I'm glad that you can see me and not smell me because I ain't, I'm telling you, man.
Why you got to go like that?
It's real up in this piece, man. But
why you got to go there?
Speaking of social distancing, we decided to flip this topic up today and we decided to tackle the topic emotional distancing.
Oh, no.
Emotional distancing, man, because you know, right now, you know, everybody, everything is shut down. We doing this thing, social distancing. We're supposed to keep our space, and you know, we're not supposed to interact with a whole lot of people, and you know, we're supposed to stay indoors,
in
keep
your house
locked down, all that kind of stuff, man. And you know what? We kind of do that a little bit as people, a little bit as men, maybe even a little bit as women. Emotionally, man, where we emotional distance. What you think, man?
Man, I'm taking a seat. Okay. Take a second, take a breath. How do I want to go with this? Yes. First of all, yes. I know that in my experience for me, I emotionally distance and I keep myself shut down because I'm an empath. I'm emotionally sensitive. I'm energetically sensitive. And so a lot of the times I feel more than even what is me. And so, yes, I will emotionally distance. However, sometimes I feel like I know I had experience recently where I was not getting a lot of attention. And wasn't really hanging out because it was everybody's busy, everything. And then recently I got to hang out with somebody and then I felt complete. I felt like, okay, I got my touch quotient. I got my attention, whatever. And now I'm like, oh yeah, I'm just cool. I'm just chilling. And then I realized, well, wait, I need to reach out to this person and thank them for hanging out because they may not realize that I'm not reaching out because I am content, because I am full, because I did get my fill of, attention. And so that, you know, and that I would say that may be the good type of emotional distance, because it's not like you're distancing for negative reasons, but it may just be because, oh, well, I'm feeling complete. I don't necessarily need to reach out or whatever. But even in that, I sent a note like, hey, thanks so much for hanging out. It was so good. I'm feeling so content right now. And they're like, oh, thanks so much for reaching out and letting me know, because I thought maybe this was you didn't like me or we weren't friends no more or something. I'm like, no.
Yeah.
What's your experience been, man, like?
No, I'm talking purely from, I'm talking experientially from a negative perspective, okay. Man, where, you know, there's something out there that we don't want to catch.
Yeah.
And there's something out there that we are afraid of, something out there that we've been made to fear. There's something out there that we've been made to run away from. And so we shelter in place. We quarantine ourselves. You know, we go buy all the toilet paper and we load up, we fill up our pantry, we hoard, and we shut it down and we lock in and we say, you know what? I'm not going out into that scary world. I'm not going to expose myself to that thing that I don't want to catch. Uh-huh. And that thing that I don't want to catch is feelings. Uh-huh. Mm. Maybe well, I don't want to catch feelings. Maybe what? Feelings is like the COVID 20.
It's the COVID 2020.
The COVID feelings. 2020 is the feelings. And so we emotionally distant, man. So we get emotionally where I'm gonna shut that thing down, man. I'm not gonna clean it up. I'm not gonna brush. I'm gonna keep it funky, you know, and I'm just gonna be emotionally distant, man. And you know what? Don't nobody even want to be around this when I'm like right now. It's like you don't want to be around this physically. I mean, in this moment, not in this space right here, because I ain't smelling.
What, you don't want to freak the funk? You don't want to share the
funk
world?
No, man. And when we don't clean up all that emotional baggage, all that emotional garbage, when we don't shave or shower or when we don't do any of that kind of stuff, we end up just emotionally stinky, man. And even when we want to find somebody, we stink too much, man. And eventually that person can put up with the funk for a little bit. But then after a while, it's like, oh, you kind of stinky. You know, then all of a sudden you can't ignore that funk no more. And it's like, man, I got to bounce because you humming right now. And you know what I'm saying? So emotionally, I think we do that from a negative perspective, man, where we just, you know, we don't want to catch that thing, man. We don't want to catch that thing that hurt us in the past. Mm-hmm. We don't want to catch that thing that disappoints us. And it's kind of dangerous. And maybe that thing is intimacy. Maybe that thing is, you know, is feelings. Maybe that thing is vulnerability. Maybe that thing is communication. Maybe that thing is exposing my heart. I don't know. But either way, I think we can shut that thing down emotionally so that we distance ourselves from other people and we don't go there no more.
Yeah. I mean, you basically said it all in a nutshell. It's what are you afraid of? Like what is the inner work what is the thing that we're sensitive about? What is, you know, how many times we got to say wounded people wound people? And sometimes in our own wounding, we're the wounded animal. We're scared. We're snapping at people. We're not taking care of ourselves. We dug ourselves a little hole in the ground and we're just staying in a hole because it's safe because we're afraid of being hurt again because we haven't healed the trauma, the wound. And I will reiterate until probably the day I die. I mean, working on yourself is number one. Number two is sharing that with somebody that's safe. And number three is to have this vulnerability and this compassion with each other of sharing our wounding, sharing what we're afraid of. I think I, you know, and this would be something I would love to hear comments from our ladies and from the viewers.
Type it down.
How sexy would it be if you got it? You were on a date with somebody and it doesn't have to be day one. I know first dates are this whole thing. Everybody wants to just have fun on the first date and just not be real. But how sexy would it be if you're on a date with somebody and they're like, you know, I dig you. I like you. I think there might be a future here. I'm afraid. And I'm going to be open about my fear. Like I'm afraid of being hurt again. Mm-hmm. And this is what my experience was. And now you're aware of what they're afraid of. So number one, you know what their hot button is. You know what their fear is or what their vulnerability is or what their, you know, wounding is. And then if you share that with them, now you have some glue to work with. You got some sticky, some deep stuff that you can actually latch onto to create something with. You got some mud to make adobe with and build this house with. I mean, I would love to hear comments about that because I know some people be like, nah, that's too much. But I mean, really, if somebody was to say to you, this is, you know, I dig you. I think you're awesome, but I'm afraid of dot, 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 because this is my experience. What do you think about that, man?
You know, man, I think with even this thing that we're doing now, social distancing, right? What we're really trying to, and I think a lot of it is fear generated, which emotional distancing is the same thing. But this social distancing, man, we're trying to run, we're trying to hide. And what we're doing is we're trying to be safe. And we're going into our comfort zone. We're going into our homes. You know, we're get away from that big, bad world out there. You know, I mean, go into your safety place, go into your comfort zone, go into that place that is a controlled environment. And that's, you know, when we do that emotionally, we go into our emotional comfort zone. We get into the places where we don't want to be emotionally dangerous or vulnerable. But the reality is nothing good or profound anyway ever happens in the comfort zone.
Yeah.
Safety is not safe.
No, I mean, if you're not, you don't have any skin in the game. If you don't have any chips on the table, if you're not betting big, your reward is not big. You're not going to, there's no chance for anything of substance.
And then we see like the person that is the, you know, the one that ventured everything, the one that made it big, made it that. Well, I'm talking about like in culture, you know, we see the actors and the actresses and the entrepreneurs, and we see the people that are the tip of the spear and everything. And it's like, you're never going to have that greatness as long as you're looking for safeness.
Yeah.
But we do that. I know, right? We do that emotionally, man. We want a great connected life. Like, we want relationships and fulfillment, but that ain't never going to happen in our safety, emotional comfort zones, man. But that's what we try to do.
Yeah. I mean, it's brass tacks. It comes down to, what are you willing to risk? Are you willing to risk to be open and vulnerable, mm-hmm. to get the big prize? And I think that, mm-hmm. we've become so conditioned in our social media world, and even in our, you know, out of whack masculine feminine energy, that we just assume the worst. And if we're not doing the work on ourselves, we're not looking at, well, what is it that I'm afraid of? What is it that I'm working on? What is it that, you know, what am I willing to risk? Mm-hmm. Then we're not, we've just been so conditioned to, well, if they're not perfect, why bother? Or if they don't have all this, why bother? But are we doing our work?
Yeah.
And I see a lot of it. I know we've talked about before, there's a lot of surface.
Yeah.
There's no depth, you know, mile wide and inch deep. Mm-hmm. That's what we're dealing with. But we, mm-hmm. all want that mile deep. We, mm-hmm. all want that depth. So, mm-hmm. what are we willing to look at? And it starts in the mirror. Sorry. Yeah. Yeah, no magic pill here, folks.
Dude, at some point, in order to get away from this social distancing, whenever this thing ends and it's like, okay, you all can go back out into the, mm-hmm. world, we all got to take a collective shower.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Please don't stop social distancing until you take a shower. Like, make that the first thing you do, because all y'all know exactly like I do that you humming right now.
Yeah.
And so you got to clean that thing up. You got to go in to the mirror. You got to go into the place. You got to go into whatever that proverbial metaphorical shower is, and you got to, mm-hmm. clean all that stuff up. Because otherwise, man, I'm telling you, what we end up doing is just running. Yeah. We just end up running from all that stuff out of fear that we're afraid of. And when it shows up, even in a relational setting, it shows up like the person that just disappears, the person that ghosts. You know, we're dating, and all of a sudden, poof, we're out of here. Maybe, you know, we don't talk too much like anymore, like even in relationships or when you are dating, or, you know, I like this, I don't like this, you know, this ain't working out for me or whatever. We kind of get in and we like, nah, I'm out of here. We pull the ejection handle and we just ghost and we just bounce. And that's what happens.
That's a great point, because we have socially distanced so much. We've had the social media distancing, and there's so many options now. And there's, you know, you can get on your phone and talk to 30 different people all at once. And so now we've stopped taking the time with one person. There's no communication. There's no, mm-hmm. one-on-one. There's no like, hey, we're dating, but I'm feeling this, mm-hmm. and I want to address this. Let's talk about this. I'm, mm-hmm. feeling this. Or maybe even just being honest, like, I like you. I'm not there to go serious, or, mm-hmm. I'm not, but this is what I'm feeling. And I would like to, maybe we hang out once a week or every couple, yeah. weeks, or, I mean, just talk about it, just be, yeah. real, because if we're not being real,
yeah.
then we're not going to find our real people.
Yeah. Yeah. And but, I mean, nowadays, if it's uncomfortable, then we you know, we can just like leave. And you're right. In terms of the abundance, I think it's a cultural thing. When you live in a world of such abundance, then enough never really is. you know, and when you can, if, whether it's a, let's say it's a dating perspective, when you can go on a dating site and there's 30, 40, 50 different options, you can say, okay, yeah, this is great, but maybe there's a BBD, a bigger, better deal out there. Right. You know, I know you thought I was going to, no, maybe there's a bigger, better deal out there that, right. You know, that I can, you know, that I can kind of, you know, lean to, or maybe there's something else, an option or whatever. And nowadays, you know, just even with this cultural thing, this social distancing, you know, we rush out, we got to go to the grocery store and we got to buy everything. You know, and it's like, no, I'm, you know, what about just enough? Yeah. What about just enough? And what do you have in your pantry, in your refrigerator? We don't do that deep stuff, man.
No. And I think this is a great opportunity and something that has been coming up for me is that, cause I've had this experience before where I was in a situation where either I lost my job and I was having a hard time finding one. And so I had to really like chunk down to like the basic necessities where I was mm-hmm. just staying at home and not spending any money. And, you know, all I would let myself do is go to the movies. But mm-hmm. what I found was after a week or two of that social distancing of that, just being with myself, a lot of that manicness, a lot of that stuff that's causing these shortages of people to run out or people to not look at themselves, a lot of that fell away. And it was just mm-hmm. me, just who I am. And then coming out of that, I felt really grounded in myself. I didn't need people. I wasn't needy anymore. I wasn't mm-hmm. feeling like I was missing anything. I think this is a great opportunity as a society, as people in general, to take the time. And I know for a lot of you with kids and you're homeschooling now, so there's like no real opportunity for you to be by yourself. But maybe for the singles, you have the opportunity of being by yourself. But even if you got family, you had this opportunity of like chunking down to just your family group and really like being creative and finding things that work for you and getting an opportunity to get to what's real, what's really important. Because I think, I mean, obviously we have not been focused on what's really important, what's really needed, because people clear out the toilet paper shelves for a respiratory thing. So it's like, you see where, and it's like, I was talking to somebody the other day and I thought it was funny because I love to quote the Men in Black from the first one, you know, it's like, you know, a person is smart and intelligent, but people are dumb, panicky, scared creatures. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of the thing. If we're not focused on what's truly important, what we need, and then not focused on supporting each other, we do things like this. We run out and buy, hoard things and do crazy things that don't make any sense whatsoever.
We do stuff that don't make sense, man. You're right. I mean, we're hoarding toilet paper. This is, you know, it's a respiratory illness. It's not a buffet at Casa Bonita. you know, but here's the deal though, when it all hits the fan, what do we worry about? We worry about the crap.
Yeah. I mean there's a metaphor right there.
We worry about the crap. And it's like, dude, I mean that we get all off base, but that's what happens when we get into the hoard, that panic, that fear mentality. And then we, you know, again, that has played out in a social perspective. But again, to me, the parallel is also from an emotional perspective. And if you ever, you know, if you're an entrepreneur out there, or if you're a business owner, or if you're a change agent or a light bringer, whatever you want to call it, you can't do that in secret.
No.
Like, you have to put yourself out there. You have to show people who you are. You have to, you can't live distanced emotionally. I mean, you have to be able to express who you are, whether it's professionally, whether it's privately, relationally in terms of family, relationally in terms of romantically, whatever that is. But we can easily get to the place where we fear that thing. And when we fear that thing emotionally, we do the parallel of social distancing, which I'm thinking is emotional distancing, man.
Yeah. And a good point too is, we tend to project those things that we fear. If there's something within you that we, you know, if you haven't dealt with that pain, if there's something mm-hmm. that, you know, some scar or wound you haven't dealt with, we tend to unconsciously project that on the other people. So if you're wondering why I keep getting these same type of people, these same mm-hmm. people, the same kind of wound, or the same people mm-hmm. that treat me this same kind of way, it's because something within you has not been dealt with. And then you will think that all those people and all the people out there, they all are broken that way, or they all have mm-hmm. this issue. And they're just a reflection of you. I mean, the mm-hmm. world is an amazing mirror. It is an amazing reflector. It will tell you exactly what you need to look at mm-hmm. by your experience. Mm-hmm. So if you keep having that experience, if you keep getting emotionally distanced, or keep getting ghosted, or you keep getting people who treat you bad or whatnot, yeah. what is the thing in you that's like, oh, okay, well, that's a mirror for me. So what do I need to look at for myself?
Yeah, been there, done that. And, you know, I mean, as you know, even these days, sometimes I'm still like, But
it's a never ending process.
But we do end up in those cycles, man. And like I said, I've seen it play out. I've seen it play out in different ways, personally, from really both sides of that whole thing. In terms of, you know, there was no way I would ever let anybody see inside of me. There was never a way that I would allow any part of me to ever be seen. And so it kind of trips a lot of people out that have known me for a long time to see me so vulnerable today. Because that was always something that I had always held back. And so, I've been the person that just disappeared. Like, you know, as soon as I felt uncomfortable, as soon as I felt like somebody was getting close or a little bit too close, I'm out of here. Like, I'm not even going to say nothing. Like, for real, you just turn around and I'm just gone. Yeah. And now, you know, now I try to be a little bit more upfront, a little bit more, you know, as much as possible, open with who I am and where I am and that kind of stuff. And you know, but then, like I said, I've also experienced the other side of that, of, you know, being there, being all the way there, and then peace out, you know. And I mean, you've heard the stories, man. You've seen me cry in my soup.
I've been there. You know, it's not even just you, but even in my own experience. And it's really tough, because I just like everybody else, I would love to be the victim. I would love to say, oh, no, it's them, it's not me. And, but at some point, you got to look at yourself. And I mean, there's a reason I've been single so long and spend so much time working and studying and digging deep, because I realized it was me. Mm-hmm. And it is a work in progress. But what I think we can do is, okay, now we have this awareness. We know that we have a tendency to emotionally distance ourselves. We have a tendency to be triggered. Mm-hmm. And what are the tools that we use when we get triggered? Like, you and I we can talk to each other and be like, so am I getting this right? Do I think it's like this? Or do you think it's like that? Or we can talk it out. But for you guys out there, what tools do you have in place? What support systems do you have when you feel triggered, when you feel emotionally like distancing? What can you use to even just talk about or to acknowledge that? Because I think everything starts with our own acknowledgement. Step one is acknowledging that I have a problem, you know? So what do I do? What, you know, do you have a support system? Do you have somebody you can talk to that can help you to maybe see it a different way? Because I know a lot of times, is in my experience especially, I'll make up a story and then I talk to a couple people and they go, maybe it's this. And it's like, oh, that's it. I hadn't thought of it that way. Maybe it is. And that makes me feel so much better to think something, to have a different perspective versus, oh, no, it's all them.
I agree, man. You know, I just said this within the last 24 hours to somebody that, you know, most of the time, a lot of time, you know, your greatest problem and your greatest solution is in the mirror. Oh, yeah. And, you know, and that's where it begins, and that's where it can end as well. And so when we deal with those kinds of things, man, but, you know, we got to get to the point, culturally speaking, where we're able to emotionally connect again. We got to be able to re-assimilate to the idea of connection, to the idea of communication. Just like whenever it is we come out of this social distancing thing, we're going to have to re-assimilate to what it's like to go to the grocery store and only buy what you need. What it's like to go to an office, if you have an office, and go to work, you know, where they didn't send everybody home for 2 months, you know, kids going back to school and all. We're going to have to relearn how to interact with people and how to communicate with people and how to do all that where it's not on a screen. You know, our screens today, for the most part, are two dimensional. That third dimension that we're missing is depth. Yeah. And so we're going to have to learn how to live in depth socially. We're also going to have to learn how to culturally live in depth emotionally and to connect. And we're more than just two-dimensional beings. We're more than just height and width. We're depth as well. And that not only is a social thing, but it is an emotional thing as well, spiritually too, I guess.
Oh, yeah. Well, and that's one of the good things. And what I'm personally, people think I'm nuts, but I'm personally very excited about all this craziness going on, because it is forcing us to look deeper. It is forcing us to get out of our own way in some ways. Yeah. And what I foresee happening is, once this is over, man, the bars and restaurants are going to be full. People are going to be going out. It's going to be, there's going to be this rush on just connection and community. And I'm excited for that, because without these strange things going on, without these emergency situations, whatever, stuff that really break up the monotony. We just get into the hamster wheel of routine. Mm-hmm. And we just distance ourselves. We isolate ourselves. Mm-hmm. And then we don't know any different.
Yeah.
That's just our routine. That's just what we're used to. So this is actually, I think, a huge blessing once we get through it, because people are going to realize how much they miss community, how much they miss connection. Yeah. And number one, the one thing I keep telling people, this is a blessing because it shows us how interconnected we truly are.
Yes.
This is not just a us against them sort of thing, or I'm fine by myself. Like, we don't realize how much we need everybody else to do their job, and how much we need everybody else to be safe and be happy and be healthy. Mm-hmm. But now we're getting a picture of it. I mean, having been in the shipping industry for years and being a professional truck driver for years, 99% of things are touched by a truck driver. They are on their truck. Mm-hmm. And we think, oh, well, no big deal, not a big problem. But now look, when you make a run on toilet paper and meat and all these different things out of fear and panic.
Yeah.
And then now we don't have necessarily the same support systems even for the truck drivers.
Yeah.
So it's just showing us how interconnected and how much we really need each other, which I think is a huge blessing.
And, you know, a lot of the people that we can take for granted, a lot of things that we can take for granted, all of a sudden, you know, you don't get to take for granted when you don't have it, or when you need it, or when you depend on it. You know, I was in a grocery store and I just bought a few things. I intentionally thanked the guy that was stocking the shelves.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, he was kind of like, huh? But I said, man, thank you for working so hard, man. I appreciate it. And to be appreciative of the over the road truckers and all that kind of stuff.
The grocery store people
and just, you know, the person that's waiting tables, and to appreciate them, and the, you know, bartenders, the people in the service industry and all that kind of stuff, man, to appreciate all these things. So you're right in terms of this bringing us hopefully back to the point where we get just a small glimpse of the fact that we do need each other. And hopefully when we see that, then we can also see that we have some work to do to reconnect, to connect with each other, and to appreciate each other, and to experience the depth in humanity. Yeah. The depth in humanity is important, man.
Yeah, I mean, there's such a need for this right now. And I think it's, whether you're ready for it or not, I think it's kind of been thrust on us, and we're learning the hard way, maybe, unless you're prepared for it, or you're actually doing this work yourself. But what I'm finding, and this may be your experience as well, but not panicking, trusting, being grateful. Mm-hmm. Like, I was down to almost out of toilet paper, and because I didn't pay any attention to the news, I don't watch the news, and so I didn't think about it. And I thought it was a joke, and then I went to the grocery store, like, oh wow, there's nothing on the show.
Yeah, it's real.
So a friend of mine actually posted on Facebook, like, I have extra if anybody needs it. I was like, awesome. Mm-hmm. I'll raise my hand because I did need it, and so I went, drove up, and got it. And then on my way back, I stopped at a grocery store just to pick up a couple more things. And as I'm at the grocery store, grateful that I have toilet paper, grateful that I can still go pick up things. They just got a new shipment in, so the manager in the back store going, "Hey, you need some toilet paper?" I was like, "Well, all right, I'll take some of that too." Mm-hmm. And now I have extra that I can give to somebody else in my car.
Right.
But it was just interesting how being in gratitude and not worrying, knowing that we're taken care of, knowing that there's something bigger than us that has our highest good in mind.
Yeah.
If you're not in panic, because that panic and that lack mindset will bring you nothing but things to panic about and to be like in a lack mindset about. But if you're grateful for what you do have, and this is such a great opportunity. It's the first day of spring and it's snowing outside, but I'm warm. I got food in the fridge. I got endless entertainment. Mm-hmm. I'm very grateful for that.
Yeah.
Gratitude begets gratitude.
Yeah.
But if you're in panic, shift, take some deep breaths, count to 10, do whatever you need to do. Hug your pets, your kids, your cats, whatever. Mm-hmm.
Just being able to realize that, man, I have enough. Like, I mean, and most of the rest of the world lives on not even enough, lives on just below enough.
Less than a dollar a day is a lot of people.
We call that the third world, but a third of the world lives like us. Oh. And so, you know, to be able to appreciate just the basic things that we have, man, and to be thankful for that, and to understand that I'm good, like right now, like I'm good. You know, at some point, you know, I'm going to not have a whole lot of toilet paper around here because I didn't go out on the thing. So I might be reaching out, but whatever. Point is, I got enough for right now. Yeah. I mean, at this point, my kids aren't here. So at this point, I only got one butt in this house, right? So, I mean, I don't need but so much toilet paper this week.
But you know that once you run out, that you'll be provided for. There'll be enough. Somebody's going to have some. So it's like knowing that you're going to have that option. And even with the emotional distancing, Mm-hmm. Knowing, like, being grateful for what you do have,
yeah,
and even being honest about, okay, well, I'm very grateful for this attention that we've had together and we got to share. Yes. I'm feeling a little triggered, or this is what's going on with me. I mean, we need some transparency, people,
yeah,
in all walks of life. Just be honest, because what I find, in correct me if I'm wrong, but 9 times out of 10, we make up a story in our head about how this person's going to respond, how they're going to be. And so we don't tell them what's really going on. But then when you take that, you know, the 20 seconds of bravery and just say, hey, I'm feeling this way.
Yeah.
Then these people go, oh, thank you so much for telling me. That's awesome. And they don't act the way you think they're going to act. They don't have the response you think they're going to have.
Yeah. I mean, and, you know, even in the story, the little anecdote that you just told, part of the key of you having enough was the idea of sharing.
Yeah.
And so that's on a social perspective. On an emotional perspective, same thing. Having enough sometimes comes down to just sharing. Sharing what you have or what you don't have, the lack of or the abundance of. And quite often that can be that ends up being an exchange of, I'm sharing this. I'm either sharing what I have or I'm sharing what I don't have. I'm sharing something that I'm struggling with. I'm sharing something that I got plenty of, whatever it is. But when we begin to share emotionally, when we begin to open up and connect on that level, then we can grow. Then we can feel the security and the safety, not in me, but in we.
Yeah.
See, there's way more safety in we than me.
Yeah.
Because me is finite, but we can be infinite, right? I mean, we multiply.
Yeah.
You know, maybe I can add, but you and me together, we multiply, man. There's the whole idea of being fruitful and multiplying. Yeah. But I mean, so the safety is not in, I mean, that's just, I'm kind of stuck on that because it's phenomenal.
Yeah, go ahead.
The safety is not in me. The safety is we. We are stronger together than we are apart. And when we come together socially, when we come together culturally, when we come together economically, when we come together emotionally, relationally, vulnerability wise, we are way stronger than me. Yeah. And so that begins with a sharing, though. There won't be a we unless we share. Unless we share the me.
I mean, it may be sound contrite, but even if you change I to we, then even illness becomes wellness. And in the sharing, whatever you're feeling, you are going to connect with somebody else, because it's, you know, the only difference, and I don't know how many times I'm gonna say this, probably a million times in my life, I'm gonna say it again. The only difference between a stranger and a friend is the simple phrase of me too.
Mm-hmm.
And if you share yourself, that person go, oh, me too. I have that in common. I do that too. I am also a human being, me too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That vulnerability, man. Vulnerability is the key to allow somebody else to say me too. Yeah. Because a lot of us think we're the only ones on that island. And so that the ability for us to share even some deep and vulnerable things. There are times where you need to be wise with that. You can't go sharing everything with everybody. But in the appropriate setting, when we begin to share, then we do allow somebody else to say me too. Now we have community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When we have community, now we're strong.
Yeah. And the more people you share with, the larger your community grows, the more permission you get to other people to share, to be open, to be vulnerable. And the more we share, the more connected we are. And that's, I think, whether there's an agenda or not an agenda or whatever, part of the social media illness is the fact that we believe we're sharing over social media, but we're more isolated because what we're sharing is contrite. It's cultivated. Right. It's not truth. It's not depth. It's very shallow. But in person, being in person, look somebody in the eye.
Yeah. And you know, I'm going to be selfish, man. And I'm going to say, I'm going to call it out. This is why I like what we do as opposed to a lot of whatever else I see on social media. And as opposed to the talking head, the Facebook prophet. I like the idea of Mad Men of Masculinity. We both are dope. We both have superpowers, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we both are Avengers.
I got my cape right back here.
I'm just in my pajamas right now. I'm just in my Avenger pajamas. I got my Superman underoos on. You remember underoos?
Yeah.
but at the same time, this is dialogue. And that's why I think, you know, so many people, by the way, like, subscribe, share, all this other kind of stuff. I mean, join in on the conversation, comment, all that kind of stuff. We want to get feedback. We want to hear what you think.
Yeah. If you got superpowers and you want to be on the show with us, talk to us. We'll put you on.
There, done that. No doubt. And so, but I like this idea of a we as opposed to a me. I like we talking as opposed to me talking. Yeah. I can get on there and I can, you know, that video I put out on my birthday. that thing has almost like 900 views at this point. Like, it's coming up on 1,000. That was 9 days ago. I mean, that was pretty dope. That was a vulnerability moment for me. But and you know, you've put out stuff, man, that has blown my mind and all that kind of stuff. But the idea of you and I coming together, man, of you and I doing this whole thing, is a we, man, and it's not just about me. And I think that's why so many people have begun to latch onto this thing. Subscribe to Mad Men of Masculinity page, like that too.
When we get the dreams. I mean, it's all about a sharing, because I learned so much. I mean, talking to you, talking to people, it's about the growth. And I mean, selfishly, I can share with you all the stuff I've read and learned, but it's the coming together. It's the sharing of the two minds. I mean, not to get overly biblical, but you know, where two or more are gathered, I mean,
yes,
that's where we get the superpower. That's where the mastermind comes in. That's where the synergy and the energy comes in. And that's where the healing comes in.
Yeah, no doubt, man. So, dude, So let's line up on the runway, man.
Runway 2-1.
Line up on the runway, man. Let's line up on the runway. Our quarantine edition,
right? Our
social distancing edition of Mad Men and Masculinity.
First day in Colorado.
Off schedule. We went early today, man. It's all good.
Oh yeah.
Man.
I mean, that's why I brought out. That's why I brought out my tablet.
Yeah, the background. I see, man.
Boy, outside. I'm like, I'm trying to get me some blue water and some heat.
Dude, I've been watching YouTube videos all day of like Maldives and the resorts and all that kind of stuff, man. I'm doing mental stuff right
Spring's
now.
Spring's coming.
I'm doing mental stuff right now, man. But lining up on the runway, man. Today, culturally, we are social distancing. Today, in actuality, you and I are talking about emotional distancing, man. What kind of a last nugget would you have for people in the area of emotional distancing?
I mean, honesty and vulnerability are the key to depth. Honesty and vulnerability are the key to get you what you want. Find some safe people to be honest and vulnerable with. Find some people that you can share with, and in your sharing and your bravery, you give them permission. You give them the opportunity to heal and be with you. So share, people. Get out there and share. And even if you got to do it in the quarantine over FaceTime, Facebook, or something like this, I mean, get somebody else on the screen with you and talk to them, because I guarantee you, you'll feel better afterwards. What about you, sir? Like, if you had some advice, some nuggets of wisdom, some Kirkisms to give people about emotional distancing and what they can do.
You know, man, it just really hit me, man. Just the idea of me, of we over me. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to emotional distancing, or the lack thereof, emotional connection, we has to be over me. And so I have to be brave enough to lean in and to have the difficult conversation, even if it's a conversation of, you know what, this ain't really working out for me. I think we need to go our separate ways, or whatever it is. Leaning in to have those difficult conversations, man. Leaning in to have the conversations of, I'm afraid of this. I'm energized by this. I'm worried about this. I'm whatever, my lack or my abundance, whatever that is, man. But to be able to share, and to be able to connect, and to be able to honor, and to go deep, and to connect heart to heart and depth to depth of person. I think we got to be able to do that as people, as a society, whether it's business, whether it's family, especially in the area of relationship, emotionally, physically, intimately, all those kinds of things, man. And so I think that's why we do what we do. And if you need a guy to talk to, if you need a guy to help you to catalyze your connection to your communication, I know a guy. His name is Jason B. Kendrick, and he's right over there. Now, if they want to get a hold of you, man, how can anybody get a hold of you to help them open up their lines of communication?
Right down here. Just go to jasonbkendrick.com. Find me on Facebook, Jason B. Kendrick, YouTube, Instagram. Just look out, reach out, find me. If you go on the website, you can email me directly. My phone number's on there. And, you know, sometimes when I'm busy, I have this other awesome dude over here, Mr. Kirk M. Samuels. If people want to get a hold of you, if they need your wisdom and your funk, the spunk,
First of all, you never have a problem knowing which way to point. I'm always the one trying to forget which way to point.
I think about it.
I don't know, man. I dig that, though. Yeah, I'm Kirk M. Samuels, the Intimacy Incubator, man. And there's my website. I mean, it's pretty easy to find, like, all over the place. My phone number is out there in the world. Easily to reach out and all those kinds of things, man, and to do what we do. You probably don't want to come around me right now because I'm smelling, but it's going to be all right. I promise I'll shower sometime in the next couple of days. You know, sometimes
you can give him a favor and give him a call so he can shower to come.
Dude, I ain't brush nothing. I ain't wash nothing in a while. But sometime in the next day or two, I will absolutely, I will bathe. But right now, you don't want none of this. But I promise, you know, if you see me in person, I will before that. But anyhow, we are the Mad Men of Masculinity. We love each and every one of y'all. Like, subscribe, share, comment. We read the comments. We reply. Yes. We interact a lot.
If you need, if you want us to talk about anything, let us know.
Topics and all that kind of stuff.
And in the great words of the great Chris McCandless, if since you're home, since you're isolated, watch Into the Wild again. But, you know, life is about sharing experience together. So make sure you share. I mean, that was the dude who wanted to be by himself the most. He went to Alaska to be by himself from the rest of the world. And he realized through his isolation, life is about sharing. So share yourself with others. Give them that gift, especially now. So get ready. Yeah. Find yourself in this isolation and get ready to get out in the world and share yourself. Because once this social isolation experiment is over with,
yeah,
it's time to go, y'all.
Yeah. It's time for us to touch and connect. Time for us to touch. Boom. All right. We love y'all. We'll see y'all later. Mad Men of Masculinity out. Mic drop.
Mic drop. Pow.